Hey there, my name is Zoran Horvat. Today I will show you what happens when you apply Entity Framework migrations as part of a deployment. You will see the steps necessary to make in a zero downtime deployment, including continuous deployment. I will show you what happens under the hood when such a deployment is executed. But I will also show you what you as a developer must do to make such zero downtime deployments possible. Let's get on to code. This is a simple web application with only one domain model. A class named person. There is the DB context, and we can just create a migration. Here, this is the migration that is introducing the new model class. Nothing special, a new table appears in the database. I will also update the database so you can imagine that this is the state of the system right now. All this has happened sometime in the past, and this is the software, including the database schema, as we have it now. Very simple application that accepts names of people. Let's add a couple of them here. Yes, everything works fine in the current version of the application. And that is one commit. So again, this is the state of the application as we have it right now, and then we continue with the development. This is where this demonstration effectively begins. What we need to do is to add a new attribute. For example, a birth year of the person, populated through the constructor, and now you can already see that this is the breaking change. There is no such information in the database, there is no data to populate this field when creating the object. But alright, let's add a new column in the UI table, add the input control for the new attribute, handle it in the post action, everything we normally do to support a new field in a class. However, it's not possible to run this application on the existing database without updating the database. I will refresh the page and here, the exception. It says the invalid column name birth year. Here is the log. This is what SQL statement was executed. Here the query is asking for the birth year column, and that column doesn't exist in the old database. So the point is that you cannot just deploy the application to staging or to production before updating the database. For the sake of development, we might just ignore the property for now to see if the UI is working. Of course, it doesn't make any sense to push this change to production. But if we run the application, it will look fine with odd data, with the defaults, and even if we tried to use the new input element, the data will be lost because there's nothing in the database to accept those data. Anyway, the UI works fine, and now we must play with the database. We need such a database schema change that can be deployed to production with production data. So there are some rows in the database table, and we must add a column, and there are basically two ways to do that. One is to make it nullable, so that all existing rows will attain a null value in the new column. The other is to supply a default. In this demonstration, I will show you what happens when you can add a default, because in this demonstration, I want to show you the order of steps when updating the production database and the production application. Those are two steps in the deployment, and you cannot just make them in any order. So let's suppose that there is a valid default for the new column. This completes setting up the new attribute. We can create the migration, but not update the database yet. The new column is not nullable, and it has a default value 1900. This is really not the best default I could come up with. And in the next video, you will even see how we will address this same problem by using the nullable column. But it will open an entire new set of problems for us, and again, we will deal with that in the next video. Right now, let's suppose that there is a valid default, and let's try to use it. What you will normally do when dealing with any customer is to send a migration script. This script will either be a part of a CI/CD pipeline, or somebody, some DBA, would run it manually or automatically or whatever. So the point is that there is a script that you generate, and I have generated an idempotent script here, and here is the alter table statement to add the column. And that is where the troubles begin in deployment, because This is the new application version. I have just committed the change to source control, so now we have a database update script and the new application source code. How do we deploy them on any environment? The old way was downtime, shut everything down, update the database, update the application, switch everything on, and keep going. Modern way is zero downtime, including automated continuous deployment. So the database script goes into the deployment pipeline, and it is deployed while the application is still running, the old version of the application. So what we need is a database update which works fine with both the old and the new version of the application, because database update is what happens first while the application is running. So this is the DDL script that runs in a transaction. Its deployment requires no downtime. It could happen that a few operations from the application that is currently running might have to wait for this transaction to commit. That is why we tend to make DDL transactions very short. Do not come up with one large update to the database schema, but many small ones, many small migrations. That will make the entire application operational while you are updating the database. And this is the situation after the update, a new database schema. But we have not updated the application yet. This is the history of versions of the application that exist. Let me check out the previous version. So this is the application that runs while we are updating the database. The old application. What will that application user see? Here, I'm refreshing the page, and it works fine. Why? Let's look at the log. The old application doesn't know anything about the new column. And even inserting new rows will work fine. The log, again. It is only inserting what it knows, the full name in this case. It's ignoring the birth year, because it doesn't know about it. But a birth year has a default in the database, and the insert passes fine. And if you liked this video, please press the like button now. That will help others discover this video as well. Thank you. Then, at some point, after confirming that the database update went fine, we can update the application. This is the code that will handle new requests. The application is up and running, and it is attached to the new database schema. Here is what the application will see. All defaults. That is precisely as we specified it. If we added new data, like Edsger Dijkstra, born in 1930, then the user supplied birth year will really appear in the database and in the UI for the first time, because now both the database and the application know about the new field. And again, the log is unveiling the mystery. New application knows about the additional column, so both the insert and select are working with all the columns, including the new one. So if you want a single important takeaway from this demonstration, it is this. There will be time when the old application code will work with the new database schema. Make your changes in such a way that that setting works. And after the entire update is done, both on the database and on the application, the new application code will work with the new database schema as you tested it during development and testing. But there will be that transient period of time when the old application code will have to work with the new database schema. So pay attention to that period, and your continuous deployment with zero downtime will be just fine. Thank you for watching this demonstration, and see you in the next video.